So, sorry, they prepared a chair for me, but I probably won't sit on it much. Okay, hey everybody, I am, from the video, it says I'm Kai, because back then they were asking me, hey, so we're gonna use a pseudonym, so like when people see you in public, they're not gonna be like, oh hey, it's that crazy chick from that one video. Nah. So like, you guys can call me Farid. And so far, from you guys see, okay, and I like to engage with my audience. I like to keep asking you guys questions. I like to, hold on, I forgot to time myself. Hold on. So I apologize in advance because I tend to like go on and on. All right, timing starts. I never script my stuff. So, all right, first of all, how are you guys today? Good? Yeah. Well? Right, awesome. Okay, so when they invited me here, they said, all right, we'd like you to share your experiences, how you, how do you face this mental illness and all that. So, first of all, I'll just lay down the basics, okay? All right, first of all, I want to ask you guys, when you guys look at me, with my first introduction here, I'm just making jokes, I'm dabbing and all that. Do you guys think I'm really mentally ill? Come on. That doesn't seem like it, huh? Well, that's okay. This is called a coping mechanism. I use humor to cope. I would like smile and say, huh, it's been a terrible day. It would be great. Let's all do a suicide pact, man. I say all this kind of stuff. Because it's my only way to cope with this. Now, so I guess I'll start by telling you guys my life story. Yeah. Now, it all started with a sperm and an egg. Okay, that's too far. It all started when, okay, I never had friends, and I emphasize on this, I never had friends. Okay, by the way, I'm speaking in English because I've been informed that there are some people here who prefer talking English. So I'm doing this for the sake of accessibility, but I can also speak in Malay as well. But if you guys wish to know more about the terms and such in Malay, you can speak to me later after this event, and I'll share my social media after this if you wish to engage with me directly. Okay, so anyway, I never had friends ever since I was in kindergarten, which was, I was like, what? Four? Until... Can you guess? Until when?
Now.
I mean, that's a bit extra, guys. Come on!
17.
Until high school, actually. Until I was form five. So, like, when you guys have those cliques at those lunch tables, you know, just everybody during recess, just at those tables, I'll be there, like, in the corner, just sitting in one table, just like over there, your typical, you know, sad movie soundtrack in the background. I'll just be there like, eating Maggie alone. So, like, and I'm serious, like, okay, I know I'm peppering this all with a lot of humor, but again, that's how I cope. I never really had any friends. Someone to talk to? Nah. Someone to, like, share my lunch with? Nah. Someone to, you know, to just be there, didn't exist, not for me. And I began to realize something was wrong when I first had my suicidal ideations, thoughts, when I was approximately 10 years old. Yeah, imagine when you were 10 years old, what was your first worry? Your first worry is, hey, do I have enough money to buy some candy? And what about me? No, I'm worrying about my existence. I'm there like, okay, the reason I had suicidal ideation is because of UPSR. So I'm the first kid of like four younger siblings, that is. So I had a lot of pressure on me. And also, I didn't have friends, and I also was actively like isolated from people, actively bullied and such. Because I was the weird kid. And So my first thought was, well, when I was 10, oh man, I don't want to do UPSR. What if I fail? What if I let down my parents? What if all this time I was just a burden to them? What if it was better if I didn't exist? And man, I was a 10-year-old. That's a bit heavy for a 10-year-old to think about, isn't it? So, and fortunately, I didn't kill myself. I'm still standing here, am I? Unless it's like a ghostly apparition. All right, thank you. Thank you for applauding my continued existence, as much as I dread it. And well, so then it expanded till, so it went on, I was 12 years old, UPSR came and gone, and when I got into high school, I was in Sekolah Datuk Pegawai Barat, and it was an elite school. So, you know, when it comes to elite schools, there's the teachers are always like, you know, they expect the best from you, and the students are snobs, pretty much, most of them. Every time I talk to someone and they say, oh, I had fun in high school, I just like, oh no, oh hell no, I didn't have any fun in high school, especially at that elite school. Because the first thing was, okay, I think that was when my depression really hit, because I was one of the problem students, because I didn't get straight A's. Can you imagine this like, yeah, Asian culture? It's, you don't get straight A's, you're pretty much a problem kid. How dare you get a B on maths and Asian? Yeah, basically. So that I'll be honest, it wasn't just that. I was really tanking in everything, and I isolated myself. I'd go and hide at, they used to have like separate bathrooms in the middle of the school, just in the middle there, and I would hide there during classes. Sometimes I'd bring a marker and doodle all over the walls. I also had like psychotic symptoms, which is I hear voices, and I also see things. So usually when I mention this kind of stuff, people are like, ooh, ada hijab terbuka, you're seeing ghosts. And I'm just like, no, it's just cats. I just see cats. And I still do now. Sometimes I'll see a random cat in the corner. Usually it looks like my dead cat, but you know. And fast forward to college. I went to a foundation program. And that foundation program was TESOL in UITM Alu Gajah, Lendu. And there was when I started getting psychiatric help. Now when I got psychiatric help, sorry if I keep pacing around, this is also one way I cope, it's to get out bad energy. It sounds like a hula good of hokey pokey, but you know. When I was at ASASI, Foundation, I went to the secondary clinic of Pekan Enas in Johor, because that's where I'm from, and they gave me a referral letter. At first, my diagnosis was dysthymia, which is basically chronic depression. It's like depression for at least, I may be mistaken here, anybody feel free to correct me, around 2 years prolonging. And after that, they diagnosed me with MDD, which is major depressive disorder. That's more like acute rather than chronic. So, by the way, I had a lot of suicidal ideations in between, but it's so common that I think if I had to mention each and every one of them, this would probably not end until like 2020. So, and the next part is, I got here and I got transferred to I got my case transferred to PPUM, Pusat Perubatan Universiti Malaya. So that's where I met a professional, and like I feel bad for saying this, but like a real psychology professional, because the ones that I met in the psychiatric clinic were pretty much just stand-ins. And Remember the Minakami slot just now? The whole, it's okay. Think positive. It'll all be all right. I've been trying to think positive for 2 decades now. And I didn't see do anything yesterday when I was having a panic attack at a police station. Like, yeah, and I actually did have a panic attack at the police station yesterday. Don't worry, I didn't commit any crimes. I didn't murder anybody. I just, traffic stuff, you know?
Yeah. That's not a crime.
You think it's not. That's what they want you to think. But yeah, and now I'm here. I've been doing talks for mental health under Light Up Malaysia, which is under the NCR organization, which unfortunately, sorry, not NCR, NRC. And unfortunately, Kainis, who is the founder of it, is not here today. But I would like to thank her for letting me be here. And like, okay, now I'm seeing my psychiatrist this Monday, actually. And I'm about to have my diagnosis be updated again, because... Now, would you guys be weirded out if I said, hey, my name is Jamil, and I'm 25 years old? That would be weird, wouldn't it? Because, like, as if there's another dude going on. And there is! He's there, but he's usually asleep at those hours. And when he's up, he sees really terrible things, really nasty things. Things that like, and sometimes it's small things, like I'd forget to do my laundry and he'd be like, yeah, cause you're a useless piece of, yeah. So like now, not only do I have a dissociative identity, I also have to deal with my current diagnosis, which is BPD, Borderline Personality Disorder. Now, the worst thing about borderline personality disorder is that word in the middle, personality, because you can't truly separate from it. It's part of your personality. And borderlines are, they tend to switch their moods a lot. And that is absolute hell. Because I'd be hanging out with a bunch of friends. Like, yeah, okay, friends. I have acquaintances, but none of them I can call them close friends. So it's like, I'd be hanging out with a bunch of people. I'd be having fun, we'd be doing karaoke, anything. And then it's like suddenly, like even in the middle of karaokeing, I could be like singing something like crawling in, like that. And I suddenly be like, I wanna kill myself. And then they'd be like, what? I could be driving and suddenly I dissociate. Okay, dissociating means you basically disconnect from reality. So like I'd be like driving on the highway and then suddenly I'd just be like, oh, this video game sucks, I want to turn it off. I'm driving in a real life highway in a piece of metal that can crash into other people and kill them. And I'd be there dissociating like, what if I swerve in front of the truck? I have this, like, these are the kind of intrusive thoughts that happened to me on the daily. And it doesn't help, there's another guy in here who keeps like messing stuff up as well. Oh, since here I've been babbling on for 12 minutes, so I'm gonna reserve the 3 for Q&A. Any questions?
How old are you?
Okay, first of all, how old am I? 21, you.
What were your triggers on your illness, everything?
My triggers. Yes. My triggers for my illness, as in what can cause me to have panic attacks. Okay, so first of all, that's the word triggers. I wouldn't discuss it any longer because I'm a linguist and I talk about the relation of language and linguistics and how it affects mental health. But for now, my triggers, which means like things that like make set you off to have like panic attacks and such. For me, it's stuff like, it can be like obvious stuff like, you know, seeing stuff like Islamophobia or seeing stuff like mentions of child death and such, because it makes me think about my family. But there's also really weird things. Like I can't like see the word darling or hear it. Because when I see or hear that word, it'll trigger me to an event that I had where a person abused me and they used to call me darling a lot. So this kind of stuff that really messes with your head, it really impedes your daily life. So that could answer his question, what some of my triggers are. Anything else? Yes.
So I'm a senior from his high school. And how are you?
Kakak Dewi kan?
Yeah.
I knew it. Okay.
So how are you now?
How am I now? Well, I attempted suicide a month ago. I ate 10, 15 of my pills. Fortunately, I just had really bad diarrhea instead. Anything else? Yes, you.
Does psychiatry really help? I mean, like, you try, and then you fail, and then you still having that shit again and again.
Okay, so, here's the thing. When I started taking medication when I was like 18, and you yourself, person who's taking the medication, can't actually see it. But my family, who saw me take it regularly, say they've seen like great improvements to my mood stability. And the funny thing is, though, I literally mentioned I attempted suicide a month ago. But like, it's because I have not been able to have access to my psychiatrist for a while due to financial and time constraints, as well as other socioeconomic factors. But I have not been able to take my medicine regularly because I have to ration it. I literally do not have enough, which is not good, right? Yeah, but see, it actually, for me, it helps. You know, I think all the Muslim ones here, at least Malay Muslims, people here, or, you know, Bumi Muslims here, know about religious parents, right?
Yeah.
I guess we just got sent to an exorcist. Yeah. Yeah, and berubat to an ustaz. And they were like, they were reading this holy words from the Quran, and they were just like grasping my head like this. And they were just like, Allahu Akbar, dari sini, like that. And of course, I was just sitting there like, there was no difference. So to some people, it might help. I may be possessed by a demon right now, but so far it hasn't come out. So anything else? I am taking as many questions as I can before I run out. Yes, you.
I just want to ask how your parents respond during your first diagnosis.
Okay. During my first diagnosis, the thing that made me the saddest was that my mom sat down with me and asked, is it my fault? And I had to tell her, and I told her, no, it's not. Like, I mean, it's not completely her fault. It's like the blame that they put on themselves. They think, what did we do? Where have we gone wrong? Is this my fault? I really appreciate like how they want to be empathetic with us, but like when they say that, I feel selfish for saying this, but they're making it about them. I'm talking about me, and they immediately turn it around and make it as if my existence is a mistake. But thankfully now they're much more understanding, other than the whole exorcist thing. Anything else? Anyone else? Yes, you.
You mentioned just now how diagnosis going on your suicidal thoughts and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And now you participated in that video for awareness and mm-hmm. here you're being all cool and funny on the stage talking mm-hmm. about mental illness. How did that happen? From that, you know, darker side, now you're like
lots and lots of denial and coping. Like, I realized that, okay, if I'm not gonna move anywhere, just wallowing in my self-hate, so might as well kick it in the face and take it with stride. So that's how I deal with it. I make funny jokes about it. But for me, one thing about it, only I can joke about my own illness because it's mine to joke about. I can say stuff like, oh, I hope I can kill myself today. But if I hear a neurotypical person, neurotypical means someone who is not mentally ill, If I hear neurotypical say, oh, this assignment is so hard, I want to kill myself, I just be there like, really? Really? Right. Ah, you wanted to ask a question.
Yes. When you have so many suicide thoughts, so often, now when you try to kill yourself, do you have another thought coming into you? No, I don't want to kill myself. Now there will be these two thoughts fighting with one another. Now how do you cope with this? Do you have this kind of thought? Because it's very easy to try to kill yourself, but try not to kill yourself. It's not easy.
Yeah.
So do you have this kind of
The funny thing is, the things that ground me, that pull me back from wanting to commit suicide, is the little things like, who's gonna feed my cat? Yeah, who's gonna feed my cat? Who's, man, I'm gonna miss that new video game they're gonna release next month. What about that new episode of that show I really love? I really want to know how that cliffhanger ends, those lousy producers. All that, even these little things, don't take them for granted. Even if you're, I know it seems weird to have your purpose of living hanging on a thread of just simple household stuff, but if that's your lifeline, hold on to it. And finally, person at the back who wanted to ask a question, who was it? Yeah. Humor. Drawing. I draw a lot. I'll give you guys my social media right after this question, because it says I'm in 20 minutes. I'm sorry for the organizers. And I draw a lot. I can give you my Twitter for that. And I also play video games. Video games and technology was my number one form of escapism. When I didn't have family members, when I didn't have friends, I had technology. At least I could depend on them. So that's why I'm much of a techie now. I fix laptops, I play a lot of games, I keep up with the tech news, because to me they're much more personal than what people think it is. So unfortunately, it says here that I've already taken 5 minutes more than my actual slot time. So if you guys want to ask anything, talk about anything, you guys can follow my social media. Get your phones out now, buddies. All right, if you guys have Twitter, you guys have Twitter? I'm pretty sure most of you have Twitter. Okay, look for F-A-R-I-D, Farid, E-A-C-S. Should be Farid Dix. Listen, I might be 21, but I have a humor of a 12-year-old. So yeah.
That person too.
Farid, E-A-C-S, Faridix. And that is also my Instagram, Faridix as well. And if you wanna check out my art, it's on Twitter, at RJDraws. DRAWS. So there's my Instagram, Faridix, and my main Twitter, Faridix as well, and my art Twitter, RGDraws. So you guys can check out my art there. I'm open for commissions. Please DM me if you want some art. Yeah. Okay. So sorry for whoever who provided me the chair where I just sat on for dramatic effect. And I thank you guys all for listening. And if you have any questions and want to just want someone to talk to, even if it's not about, you didn't even have to come to my DMs just for like personal stuff like, oh, I think I might have depression. Yeah, I mean, I'm up to hear about that. But also you can just be all, oh, you wouldn't believe what Fatima did today. Yeah. So thank you guys for your time and thank you for listening.